Hello, everybody, and welcome back to week three here on SVTV. I'm Buddy Strange, and this is the week three wrap-up and pick'em. And we have 16 games to go through, so let's just get into it. First off, the win of the week is going to be the Bears. I mean, come on. Eddie Pinheiro, that was an impressive kick. That was a damn good kick. And I am so glad the Bears finally have a kicker that can win them a game. It was a good sight to see for Pinheiro. Proud of him. I will say, however, that roughing the passer on Bradley Chubb was, bullshit. But that aside, Trubisky still had to make a great play, run up in the pocket, throw it, Allen Robinson catch, get down. That was the fastest timeout I've ever seen in my life. Like, they called it with 0.03 seconds left on the clock. But hey, they did it. Pinheiro still had to make a 53-yarder, and the dude did it. Congrats to him and the Bears, win of the week. All right, the loss of the week is going to be the Chargers losing to the Lions. Are you kidding me? Oh, that was like one of my lock picks. Like, that was going to be in the bag. Chargers coming in to Detroit and winning, and they lost it 10-13. Phillip Rivers threw a bad interception. All of his sisters were in the crowd. If you didn't see, here it is. But no, it wasn't a good game for him, and the Chargers ended up losing. Kerryon Johnson had a really good play here. Watch that too as I talk. No, Darius Slay had himself a game. That Lions defense did really well against a more than competent Chargers team. Eckler had a bad fumble. It wasn't a good day for the Chargers, and they ended up losing to the Lions. All right, let's get to SVTV's Players of the Week. First off, Offensive Player of the Week, Patty Mahomes, baby. It has to be. That was a very impressive performance. Threw four TDs in one quarter. That is amazing in itself. But then he was like, you know, my job's done, and dipped for the rest of the game. After the second quarter, he spotted the Raiders 10 points and was like, nah, chief, I get this. Very impressive day from Patty Mahomes. Some honorable mentions: Dalvin Cook, OBJ, DeMarcus Robinson, who caught two of Patrick Mahomes' TDs, but nah, it had to be Patrick Mahomes this week. All right, Defensive Player of the Week is going to be Jamie Collins, getting two interceptions, one pick six. Think he threw in a sack in there, had four tackles or something like that. Very impressive day by Jamie Collins. He one-handed a bobbled interception and took it to the house. Very impressive. Some honorable mentions: Shaq Barrett had himself a week, three sacks, numerous pressures on the quarterback. It was like he was on Cam Newton every single play that he was on the field, and he was a big reason why the Bucks won. Myles Garrett also getting in there three times. He's an honorable mention, but no, Jamie Collins, he had the all-around package deal on Sunday, and I just had to give it to him. And then Special Teams Player of the Week, we already mentioned him in the episode earlier, Eddie Pinheiro. I mean, come on, any Bears kicker wins a game on a 53-yarder, and it's automatic, baby. I almost gave it to Robbie Gould, but another former Bears kicker, but no, I had to give it to Eddie Pinheiro. He deserved it with that game winner. That was amazing on his part. So there you go, Special Team Player of the Week, Eddie Pinheiro. All right, everybody, are you ready? It's SVTV's Play of the Week.
In stride, OBJ. He comes back to MetLife and does this. How about it, Odell Beckham Jr.? 89-yard touchdown.
All right, everybody, I hope you enjoyed SVTV's Play of the Week. Now, let's get into how we did last week, and we did really bad. not really bad, but definitely not up to the level I want to be picking at. We did way better than last year's week two. We went 48% last season in week two. We jumped it up to 50% this year, so we are showing improvement on a year-to-year basis, or a season-to-season basis, not a weekly basis, because we were 73% last week, 50% this week. There were some tough games. Lions winning over the Chargers, definitely one of them. That Saints-Rams game. The Saints, damn it, refs. Damn it. No one can say for sure. I definitely cannot. But if the refs get that call right, don't call Cam Jordan down. He runs for a touchdown. That's momentum in the bag, baby. And when you take that away from him, that's just morale deflating, you know? They still gave the Saints the ball. Should have gave them the touchdown. Just called it a fumble in the first place and then automatically reviewed it, because all turnovers are automatically reviewed. And then decide if it's not a fumble or an incomplete pass. But anyway, that being said, Rams won and the Saints lost times 10 because they also lost Drew Brees. Another shocker, Buccaneers, Panthers. Are you kidding me, Panthers? Ugh. Anyway, yeah, that's a we went 50%. Not great, but we're going to try to improve in week 3. So let's do that right now. Starting off with the Titans versus Jaguars on Thursday night. Alright, the Titans looked great in week 1 and then came out in week 2 against a tough Colts team. I'm telling you, don't sleep on the Colts. Are you kidding me? The Colts are a good team. So are the Titans. They had a tough divisional battle. It's always a tough game between those two. And the Colts did come out on top, which I was proud of and glad, but also kind of wish they didn't, because my pick'em record needed it. Needed them to lose. But that being said, I am proud of the Colts. So happy for them. The Titans, coming off that tough loss, having to go to Jacksonville, who's also having their annual problems. Jalen Ramsey wants out. Him and coach had a fight on the sidelines, Doug Marrone, and now he wants out of there. And then also with the Jaguars, they went for 2 for the win, which I do respect, but they ended up not getting it. Leonard Fournette stopped short and they lost the game. That was also against a pretty solid Texans team, a Texans team who should be pretty good moving forward. So that was respect. The Jaguars defense stepped up and it definitely showed. But with that, I do think the Titans pull this one out. I think the Titans go in to Jacksonville and get the dub against the Jaguars. And I think they win 26-24 over them. I think the Titans defense as a whole can control the game. Mariota, Derrick Henry can have themselves a day. More Derrick Henry than Mariota. I think Mariota finds Delanie Walker a couple times. One may be for a touchdown. Delanie Walker has a good day. But I think Derrick Henry, he's going to run all over him. And I think the Titans come out of there with a win. All right, up next, the Bengals versus the Bills. The Bengals. Oof, that was a tough one to the 49ers. 49ers absolutely manhandled you in the pass game on defense. It wasn't a great day. Although Andy Dalton did have himself a pretty good day still. Him and Tyler Boyd had a pretty good connection throughout the day, even though they lost by a lot. The Bills, on the other hand, coming out and stunning the Giants in New Jersey. And when asked on what he thought when he almost went to New York, this is what Josh Allen had to say.
There's a chance you could have ended up in New York. Obviously, the Jets were heavily involved.
I'm in New York.
They're the only New York team, people. The New York Jets and the New York Giants both play in MetLife Stadium, which is in Florham Park, New Jersey. What can you not grasp about that? Everyone knows New Yorkers do all their business in New Jersey. Are you kidding me?
One New York team. I'm just kidding.
Anyway, no. Buffalo, New York. The Bills are hosting the Bengals. And I think the Bills are just a little too hot for the Bengals. The Bengals might play well, but I don't think it's going to be well enough. That Bills defense is fierce. That offense is starting to find its stride a little bit. Josh Allen with his new receiving targets and Frank Gore in the backfield, along with Devin Singletary. They know what they're doing. They've got a pretty good rhythm now. And I think the Bills do win 27-10 over the Bengals. I think the Bills defense can put a stop to Andy Dalton and the success he's having early. And I think the Bills come out of there with a win. All right, the Lions versus the Eagles. The Lions stunning the Chargers. Very impressive win. Kerryon Johnson, I'm glad they finally found a good running game. They had it last year with them, but it's looking pretty good. Danny Amendola is fitting in nicely with them as well. Matthew Stafford seems to really like him. TJ Hawkinson has been a really good run blocker as well as a receiver for Stafford. Very impressed with him so far. And then the Eagles coming off a rough body bag 2.0 type game against the Falcons. Everyone was dropping like flies, which gives a whole new meaning to the phrase, fly, eagle, fly. Anyway, no, the Eagles versus the Lions, I think it's going to be in Philadelphia, so that definitely does give them the edge. And I see the Eagles winning. That's a tough one after the Lions beat the Chargers. They've got a lot of momentum. But I do see the Eagles winning 30-28 over the Lions. I do think Matthew Stafford has himself a big day against the Philadelphia Eagles secondary. But for some reason, I think the Eagles, Carson Wentz, they have just a little bit bigger of a day. Miles Sanders might have himself a breakout game. I'm not sure. But I do think the Eagles pull it out in the end. Kind of wouldn't be surprised if the Lions get them just based on the Matthew Stafford wide receiver against Eagles secondary matchup. That's going to be tough for the Eagles. But I do think the Eagles pull it out. Maybe a sack fumble. Derek Barnett comes off the edge. Brandon Graham, someone disrupts the pocket, creates a play, and they get good field position, swaps momentum, something like that. Anyway, Eagles win. All right, Jets versus the Patriots, and I'll just give it to them. Patriots win this one, 34-9. I think you know why. At the moment, the Jets are Falked, and that means that they have Luke Falk for the next 3 to 7 weeks, while Sam Darnold is out with mono, or actually right now it's more the enlarged spleen that comes with having mono. It could be easily lacerated if he plays, and that could kill him, which is not good. And so he's going to be sitting out for the next month, month and a half or so. And yeah, they're going into Gillette. It's not going to be a good game, and I do think the Patriots win in this one. And our thoughts and prayers here at SVTV go out to Jets and their fans. Oof. All right, the Raiders versus the Vikings. Raiders coming off a tough quarter. Pretty much just a tough quarter. Well, a tough game. I guess they didn't score more than 10 points, and that all those 10 points came in the first quarter. But the second quarter was was the worst quarter for them, and that pretty much set the tone for the rest of the game. And it's worthy to note, in the Raiders games against the Chiefs on Sunday, it was the last NFL game that will be played on a dirt infield. So, rest in peace, dirt infield stadiums. It was nice knowing ya. Well, until the year 2145, when the NFL and the MLB, in the heat of a moment decision to reduce costs and exponentially grow their bank accounts, they form a new league called the MNFLB, or the Major National Football League of Baseball, then that's where all games will be played. They will be played on a dirt infield or a baseball field. It will be pretty much a regular football game, but all players will have to wear baseball gear, and the kickers will have to line up at home plate and kick a home run for the field goals. So in place of field goals, they have to kick it from home plate, get a home run. And you can officially steal first downs now if you are fast enough or your name is Ricky Henderson, which is especially fitting because he was an Oakland A. I love it. But for all of you worried, all you skeptics and all you naysayers, don't worry. The NFL will still have the same feel, as the rest will still miss blatant calls as well as call ghost penalties, and still no one will know what pass interference actually is. The downside is that there will be 162 MNFLB season games, as well as 4 to 7 Super Bowl games a year. So, I mean, the players might get a little weirded out, but by 2145, it's pretty much going to be all robots anyway. I mean, or bionic human beings. They'll have components. Still no roids or weed. Sorry to say that, but that's just how Roger Goodell's clone runs things in the year 2145.
I will get it right and do whatever is necessary to accomplish that.
This thing is broken!
The Vikings coming off a tough loss in Lambeau to the Packers. That Packers defense is real, let me tell you. But so is the Vikings, and I think they stop up the Raiders. I think the Vikings do win 21-13 over the Raiders. I think mostly because of Dalvin Cook, maybe a defensive touchdown as well. But Dalvin Cook is on fire, and they will continue to feed the hot hand till it is bone dry. I do think on the legs of Dalvin Cook, the Vikings win, as well as the Vikings defense holding down the Raiders. All right, the Ravens versus the Chiefs. This is going to be one of the most exciting matchups. Kind of wish it was like a Monday night or a Sunday night football game, because that would be really cool to see Lamar Jackson versus Patty Mahomes in a primetime game. I do think it's going to be a shootout. I think Lamar Jackson can feast both on the ground and through the air on a Chiefs defense that did pretty good against the Raiders, but as a whole kind of struggled. They struggled early on against the Raiders as well, but they were able to get the momentum and even things out. In this game, though, I think Lamar Jackson, Marquise Brown, Mark Andrews, Mark Ingram, Willie Snead, and the like have a big day. That being said, I think Patty Mahomes on the other side also has a big day, and that's why I'm saying the Chiefs win, but they win 36-31 in a just all-out shootout. It's going to be a fun, exciting game, and just because I said that, the score is going to be 6-3 going into the fourth, and then end up 9-6 by the end of it, calling it, or let's call it 10-9. There's going to be a touchdown scored. But no, I think it's going to be an exciting game where it's whoever has the ball last. I think it's going to be the Chiefs. We'll see how it goes. It's going to be fun. All right, the Falcons versus the Colts. The Colts coming off a pretty good win against Tennessee in Nashville as well, which is good for them as well. Brissett had a pretty good day throwing a couple touchdowns. Paris Campbell getting one. So it's cool to see the rookie finally getting some passes thrown his way. I did like Paris Campbell coming out, so that's cool. Marlon Mack was doing pretty good. And then that Indianapolis Colts defense, again, really, really good. And then on the other side, the Falcons, part of the body bag game 2.0, they didn't suffer as much as the Eagles did, I'll tell you that right now, but they did have some players go down. Desmond Trufant played really well. And this one is going to be a tough one to call, but I am going to call the Falcons losing to the Colts in Indianapolis. I think the Colts win 20-14. It's going to be a close game no matter who wins, but for some reason, I think Matty Ice is cold. Ha! Got him! Anyway, no, I think Matty Ice doesn't have a great game. Malik Hooker, who maybe Darius Leonard gets a pick, but I think he throws a couple interceptions. I think the Colts D stops him. He can't find Julio Jones, and when he tries to, he overthrows him, underthrows him. I don't think he can find his favorite target. And then Calvin Ridley might have himself a good day, but not good enough. And then on the other side, I think Marlon Mack continues to have a good season in game number 3. All right, next up, we have the Broncos versus the Packers. The Packers defense is coming in strong. Their offense started really strong, kind of fizzled out there, but still they showed glimpses of greatness. Aaron Rodgers on his game, throwing himself a few touchdowns. Aaron Jones having a big day as well on the ground. The Broncos, that was the ballsiest call by Vic Fangio. So proud of him. Went for two, got denied on a delay of game penalty. Was like, fuck it, we'll kick the field goal. Went to kick the field goal, offsides penalty on the Bears. And then he was like, screw it, we'll go for two again. And they went for two, they got it, and won the game. Yeah, no, they barely lost because Eddie Pinheiro kicked an amazing field goal. Give props to him. But the Broncos coming off a tough loss and the Packers coming off a good win. They let the Vikings almost get back into it, but were able to manage, control the game enough to not let them do that. Again, the Packers defense is looking really good. And I do think the Packers win in Lambeau over the Broncos 24-13. Wouldn't be surprised if Broncos have a little bit of an edge in this one. Vic Fangio might game plan a little extra hard, but in the end, I think the Packers defense doesn't allow Flacco or Lindsey or Emmanuel Sanders to have as big of a day as they've been having the past couple of weeks. All right, the Dolphins versus the Cowboys. We all know the Dolphins situation, and they just got rid of Minkah Fitzpatrick. That's going to hurt. Even more insult to injury, if I've ever seen it. But that being said, Cowboys looking good. Kellen Moore called another good game against the Redskins. I was really proud of him. Dak Prescott had himself a good day. Ezekiel Elliott started to get going in that last one. And yeah, I think the Cowboys do win. And the Dolphins season still continues to go downhill. They hit rock bottom, but they're still digging, baby. They want to go. They're going past bedrock, if you know what I mean. All you Minecraft fans out there, I know what I mean on that one. No, the Dolphins aren't looking great. I think the Cowboys do win 31-10 over the Dolphins. Think Dak Prescott has himself a good day. Michael Gallup is out, but Devin Smith did look pretty good off the bench for him. Amari Cooper, Randall Cobb, still are really good options. Jason Witten, still looking pretty solid for him. And then they'll give the ball to Ezekiel Elliott, and he'll do the rest. And they should have a pretty good day. All right, the Giants versus the Buccaneers. The Giants moving on from Eli. Okay. Hey, Daniel Jones, let's see what you got, buddy. The Buccaneers, on the other hand, hey, that win surprised me over Carolina, but Carolina was not looking good. However, the Bucs defense did look really solid. They are way better than I gave them credit for, and props to them. They even lost Devin White in the Carolina game, and they still performed really well, which is good to see for the Buccaneers and Bruce Arians. That offense still could use some work. Jameis Winston could still use some work, but he did look pretty solid in the Carolina game as well. I think Carolina's defensive backcourt gave him a couple, but he did execute on what they gave him and played pretty good ball. I think Shaq Barrett can have himself another big day as well. Probably not 3 sacks, but at least pressure-wise, maybe a couple sacks. I think he can get it done coming off the edge for the Bucs. I don't think Daniel Jones in his first game gets a win. I do think the Buccaneers do win over the Giants. It's going to be in Tampa Bay. It's going to be humid, hot, and the Giants coming from up north, coming trying to play in all that humidity down in Tampa. They haven't been looking great. I think some players tire out. Jameis Winston, Mike Evans take advantage of it. Maybe Ronald Jones has himself a good day. I think Saquon will be all right. He's good no matter where he plays. Daniel Jones, you know, gets some sweat in his eye as he's trying to throw a pass from all the humidity and heat and throws a pick to Levante David or Carlton Davis or someone like that. And that's the game-losing interception or something. I don't know what's going to happen. But I do think the Buccaneers win 17-10 over the Giants. I think it's going to be a close one. No matter if they score a bunch, score very little, score in the middle somewhere, I think they're both going to be neck and neck to the end, but I do think the Buccaneers pull it out. All right, the Panthers versus the Cardinals. The Cardinals coming off a pretty solid day. It was a loss to the Baltimore Ravens, but they did stick in it for most of the game. Very proud of Kyler Murray. He's throwing way too many passes for my liking, but hey, if that's what it takes. I mean, they are playing from behind. It's normal to throw a bunch of passes when you're playing from behind, but still. come on. Start off with more runs or something. It's not, oh man. You're not going to win if you don't have a running game. That's one of the biggest things in football is have a running game. All successful teams have a good defense and a good running game. Defense and running is where your bread and butter's at. That you have to be good at those things if you want to go really far. And the Cardinals are pretty good on defense, but they're not running the ball nearly enough. That being said, the Panthers are coming off a tough loss to the Buccaneers. Cam sacked 3 times by Shaq Barrett. Shaq Barrett's awesome, no doubt about it. But this week, they have to face Chandler Jones, Rodney Gunner, Terrell Suggs coming off the edge. Are you kidding me? Oof, that's not going to be great. that's probably not going to be a good matchup for the Panthers. I'd even argue that the Cardinals' secondary is a little just a couple steps above the Buccaneers. So that's also not looking good for the Panthers, even with Patrick Peterson out. The Cardinals are still looking pretty good with Buda Baker, Byron Murphy, even DJ Swearinger and Deontay Thompson. Deontay Thompson, the rookie, brings a different dynamic to the Cardinals' defensive backcourt. And then I almost forgot to mention, Jordan Hicks is a great coverage linebacker. I think he might have himself a big day for the Cardinals' defense against the Panthers. And they're going to be playing in Arizona. I do think the Panthers show up strong. Christian McCaffrey has himself a day, something like that. But I do think the Cardinals are able to pull it out over the Panthers in this one. I think the Cardinals win 24-20 against the Panthers. Panthers continue to slide down the ranks. Cam Newton gets closer and closer, be like, I want to trade or I want to retire.
Oh, screw you guys. I'm going home.
There's been a lot of players requesting trades. Well, to be fair, they're all from Florida, and I don't think Jalen Ramsey and Minkah Fitzpatrick necessarily wanted off of bad teams. They just wanted the hell out of Florida, which I don't blame them. The Cardinals win. I think Kyler Murray has a good day on the ground as well as through the air. The key to this one is, do they get David Johnson running the ball in this game? Do they get the running game going or not? If they do, I think they win. If they don't, they still can win, but I wouldn't be too optimistic about their chances if they don't get him going. All right, the Steelers versus the 49ers. Steelers, baby, get Minkah Fitzpatrick. That was their big need, but Big Ben is now out for the season. He threw a pass and in old man, old dad fashion threw out his arm and now requires surgery, which I think he's probably already got. And now he's on season-ending IR. Mason Rudolph, baby, don't sleep on him. If you've been with my channel for a while, or if you've gone back and watched some old videos from last season, I'm really high on Mason Rudolph. I think he's going to be a really good quarterback. I know I probably just jinxed him. Sorry, Mason. But you know what? Mason is too good of a quarterback to get jinxed by someone like me. That's how good he is. He does have a lot of potential, though. I believe he can be a really good quarterback in this league. He has an old face in James Washington there to help him out. Juju Smith-Schuster still there. You know, I mean, come on. James Conner out of the backfield. And if he can't go, Jalen Samuels is a pretty good back. And behind him, even Benny Snell Jr., who, if given the chance, probably is a pretty good back as well. That line should be able to keep Mason Rudolph up. And that defense, adding Minkah Fitzpatrick, is just absolutely insane. He's definitely worth a first rounder. He's going to be very versatile. He's going to be all over that defense. And between him, Devin Bush, Stephon Tuitt, Cameron Hayward, and even Bud Dupree, Joe Hayden as well, it's going to be a really good defense from here on out. I think their future is looking bright. However, on the other side, the 49ers, their defense is looking really good too. And their offense finally stepped it up. Jimmy Garoppolo having himself a pretty good day. The ground game, Josh Watson, Breida, and Mostert having a really good day as well. He had a really good day through the air too, catching the ball, Mostert. And that's why I do think the 49ers come out and win. The Steelers are not that great of a road team, at least not recently. And they have to go all the way from Pittsburgh to San Francisco. That's a tough flight all the way across America. I do think the 49ers pull it out in a close one, 28-23 over the Steelers. I think it's going to take a couple weeks for Minkah Fitzpatrick to really find where he fits on that defense. And I do think Mason Rudolph may take a couple weeks to really get rhythm with the wide receivers, but I do think they have a good chance to make a run even this season. Hey, the Indianapolis Colts last season went 1-5 and still made the playoffs. I'm not saying the Steelers are anywhere near the Colts team of last year, but they have the pieces to be a good team. All right, the Saints versus the Seahawks. This is going to be a great matchup. Drew Brees versus Russell Wilson. Oh, wait. Oh, man, that would have been a great matchup. Are you kidding me? Drew Brees versus Russell Wilson? Oh, that would have been amazing. However, Drew Brees is out about 6 weeks with a thumb injury. He tore the tendon in his thumb or something like that. Terrible to hear. He just tried to give Aaron Donald a high five, and Aaron Donald tore the man's thumb off. Are you kidding me, Aaron? Are you kidding me? That, what a dick. You know? No, it was just an unfortunate set of events. Drew Brees hit his thumb on Aaron Donald's hand and just happened to tear it. Teddy Bridgewater came in and did all right. I mean, it wasn't great, but what surprised me is they went away from Alvin Kamara and giving him the ball. I mean, again, I know they're losing, so you have to... A coach automatically thinks, hey, I've got to throw the ball to get back into it, get chunk plays. But Alvin Kamara is one of your main stars, and definitely your main star on offense now outside of maybe Michael Thomas. But Alvin Kamara, get him the ball. Don't go away from him. Even if you're losing, give him the ball. He can create chunk plays as well with his legs. He's a really good running back. That being said, it is going to be Teddy Bridgewater versus Russell Wilson. We all know how that went last time.
Dermott is the snapper.
He's going to try and put it down. And
it was all that Jeff Lockham's fault. Everyone knows that. If he had held the ball laces out like he's supposed to, Blair would never have missed that kick.
Jeff Lock
should die of gonorrhea and rot in hell. Would you like a cookie, son?
In the divisional round, when Teddy Bridgewater was with the Vikings, Blair Walsh, baby. Ooh, that to say, hey, Teddy Bridgewater is a playoff quarterback. He got the Vikings to the playoffs. And the Vikings, I guess, did have a better defense. But the Saints and the Vikings, both teams that Teddy Bridgewater were on, pretty similar. Let's see, Adrian Peterson, Alvin Kamara. I mean, not similar play types, but player potential and player star quality and playability. And I would say, offensively, the Saints as a whole are way better than that Vikings team that Bridgewater was on that made it to the division round. Wide receivers, Michael Thomas, Traquan Smith, Jerry Jared Cook's at tight end. That's a pretty good group. And that the Saints' offensive line is 10, 20 times as good as the Vikings' offensive line was. And I do think the Vikings' defense is better than the Saints' defense is right now. But the Saints' defense is still pretty good. Don't sleep on them. But that being all that being said, Seahawks, I think they get the run game going. I think Russell Wilson might, you know, Russell Wilson is Russell Wilson. I'll continue to say that till he's not. And that will be a long-ass time. Jadeveon Clowney matured in the system a little bit. I know it's only week three, but, you know, he knows the system a little bit better. Might have himself a good day. And I do think the Seahawks win 24-14 over the Saints. But what I'm saying, what I have brought up, all that Saints stuff, Saints versus Vikings, is to say I don't think Teddy Bridgewater is going to let this team down. I know he's a way different Teddy Bridgewater, but I think the Saints are in okay hands. Yes, they may lose a couple, but I doubt they go 0-6 in his time there, or however long Drew Brees is actually out. He'll lose some, but it'll be more of a team thing than a him thing, I believe. I'm just excited Teddy Bridgewater is getting the chance to start again. I'm excited for him. I hope he does really well. All right, the Texans versus the Chargers. The Chargers coming off a tough loss. The Texans coming off a tough win. They barely won over the Jaguars, who seem to be a team in trouble at the moment. That being said, the Chargers, whoa, they are not having the start that I thought they would. Maybe they're having a little playoff hangover or something like that, but they came out kind of stale for a little bit against the Colts. Eckler was able to save them that one. Phillip Rivers had some plays, but in this past one, Eckler fumbled, Rivers threw pick. It wasn't looking good. The Lions did come out to play, and they played really well, but the Chargers failed themselves. Texans have been in every game so far, won one, lost one, and this one's a really tough one. Kind of want to call the Texans, I'm not going to lie, and I would not be surprised if the Texans do win, but I'm calling the Chargers because it's in Los Angeles. I do think the Chargers come out on top. They're mad after losing to the Lions last week. Anthony Lynn will get them ready, and I do think the Chargers pull it out 21-18. Over the Texans. I think Eckler bounces back, has himself a pretty good day on that Texans defense. And I think Phillip Rivers can find Keenan Allen for a couple scores. Deshaun Watson will try. But in the end, I think Joey Bosa, Melvin Ingram, Adrian Phillips, Casey Hayward, and everyone else give the Texans problems, and I think the Chargers come out on top. All right, Sunday night football, Rams versus Browns. The Browns were finally able to kick it up a notch. Bam! Emeril Lagasse, anyway. Anyone? Anyone watch that? Anyway, the Browns finally found a rhythm last week. I think they can carry it into this next week against the Rams. The Rams had a strong defensive outing, and on offense were able to find some rhythm here and there, but defensively they looked really good. And did anybody see that hit Jared Cook took from Eric Weddle? Eric Weddle is still a beast, baby. Led to a John Johnson the third pick. And if you didn't see the play, I really want to show it, so here it is.
Cook in the air, and looks like it's picked. Throw by Brees. Cook had it knocked out, and it's the new Ram, Eric Weddle.
Man, what a hit, am I right? That was, lit him up. I love Eric Weddle, and he's one of my favorite players, and he made a great play. And that is the reason why I'm going to call the Rams. I'm going to call the Rams 28-24 over the Browns. I think it's a close game. Would not be surprised if the Browns pull it out in the end, but I think that Rams defense is going to be a little bit too much. I actually kind of think the score for both teams is going to be lower for some reason. I don't know. I think Nick Chubb might have himself a day. Odell Beckham Jr. might still have a good day. And then Cooper Kupp, Todd Gurley, who knows? But both teams' defenses are really good. I just think the Rams offensively get it done better than the Browns do offensively this week. All right, Monday Night Football. Booger McFarland in the booth. Got him. I'm just so excited for that. Bears versus Redskins should be a great game, everybody. Two teams I really want to watch in Monday Night Football because the Redskins are doing really good and the Bears offensively are on fire. Amazing matchup. I'm just... Oh, man. Could that have sounded any more sincere? Anyway, no, the Bears on defense are lighting up. They finally have a kicker. Redskins starting off really good in each game so far. They've started out fantastic. fantastic, and then they lose. They gain so much momentum. They just start out so hot, and then they end up finding a way to lose. And I don't think that's any different against the Bears here. I think the Bears do come in to FedEx Field, and I do think they win. I think the Bears defense is going to be too much for Case Keenum and that offense. Flip side of that, I think they'll struggle early on, but I think around the third quarter, Trubisky and that Bears offense will get something going. And I do think the Bears win 23-14 over the Redskins. I think the Redskins are just a couple parts away from being a pretty good team because, again, they're starting off strong. Terry McLaurin is their best wide receiver, and he's doing really well. Again, reminds me of Michael Thomas of the Saints, and should continue to be a good target for Case Keenum and Dwayne Haskins when he does finally get the job. No doubt in my mind, Dwayne Haskins is going to continue to find Terry McLaurin because they're Ohio State teammates, now Redskin teammates. That's cool. I like when that happens. Like Mason Rudolph and James Washington, it's fun to see college teammates come into the NFL together, be able to be teammates in the NFL as well. It's a fun, and especially quarterback wide receiver duo, that's always cool. Anyway, no, the Bears do win. Eddie Pinheiro gets a couple kicks in. Redskins get swallowed by the Bears defense. All right, that is going to be it for today's pick'em. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, hit that like button. If you haven't already, hit that subscribe button. Comment anything down below. I would love to hear your opinions, your bold predictions, your pick'em. Remember, copy and paste this week from the description into the comments. You can play and pick alongside me. I've got every game listed with a colon in the description, and you can just put your score or whoever you think wins, or whoever you think wins and the score if you went down in the comments down below. I would love to see how you guys do picking with or against me, however you want to view it. Anyway, that being said, also put down in the comments any players you want to see me do a highlight of, college or NFL. No promises, but I would love to hear from you guys, see who you want me to do a highlight of next. And a highlight should be coming out sometime soon. We'll see. I've got a few guys that I'm looking at wanting to do. I just haven't decided which one yet. Anyway, that being said, this is the end of today's video. So I love you guys. Thank you for stopping by. And as always, I'm Buddy Strange. This is Strange Voodoo TV. Keep it strange, everybody. I'll see you in the next one. And peace out.